الحمد لله، نحمده ونشكره ونتوب إليه ونستغفره ونسأله العفو والعافية في الدنيا والآخرة، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله رحمة الله للعالمين، خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي: يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. نشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن محمدا عبد الله ورسوله. We praise Allah. We ask Him to grant us what will give us salvation and goodness in this life and in the hereafter. And we ask Him to shower His peace on the last of His messengers, His gift to humanity, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We bear witness that there is no deity save Allah, and we bear witness that Muhammad is the servant and the messenger of Allah. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, I have been absent from the place for a few weeks, as I had the opportunity to attend to a conference about medical ethics from Islamic perspective that was held in Cairo, Egypt, where several delegates from different parts of the world were attending. As a very infrequent visitor to this part of the world, I came back loaded with impressions and with feelings and ideas that I feel that some of them are pertinent enough for us here as American Muslims, to the point that they warrant being included in a Jum'ah khutbah, because they are min amri al-Muslimin, affairs of Muslims. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam taught us that whoever is not concerned about the affairs of the Muslims is actually not belonging to their community. من لم يهتم بأمر المسلمين فليس منهم. And I thought some of those deserve to be shared. The first feeling, as I am coming back contemplating and reflecting on that short trip, is a sense of hope. And this sounds strange, because usually everyone who goes to this area of the world, including myself, come back with a list of negatives that will make the hope dim. And those negatives are real. They are not imaginary or exaggerated. They are true. And becomes aware of a set of problems that can be a bit depressing. However, I noticed overwhelmingly that there are masses and masses and masses of people who are ready to give up everything, including the needed loaf of bread, but not ready to give up their Islam. I noticed overwhelmingly, talking to rich and poor, men and women, children, adults and youth, educated and illiterates, that no matter what, they are not ready to tolerate or to accept any notion that they give up their Islam. And this in itself is creating momentums. Some of the momentums are even not that good. Nonetheless, the majority of it is a continuous search for ways to make life better, to make life as Muslims in a world that's changing on them so fast, in a world that has not been kind or understanding to them how to live there as Muslims and to improve their situation and their condition, is a relentless search by everybody. You can find someone who is upset, whose knowledge is very limited, or someone who is very sophisticated, someone is very rich, someone is very poor, but all of them are engaged in that searching for a way to affect life and to occupy a place in life as Muslims that's worthy for Muslims to occupy. And that definitely makes the person penetrates through the thickness of the problems to see a bigger picture, that Islam in reality is undefeatable, particularly at a time when we feel that there are so many factors are ganging to undermine Islam and the Muslims on a global level. But when you mix with these people, you feel that this is impossible to happen. And this is enough to give us hope. The second feeling is a feeling of responsibility on us as American Muslims. I don't have to reiterate that no matter what's happening here and our reservations about so many things, nonetheless, we are the luckiest group of Muslims on the face of this globe. Things are comparative. Things are, you can take things in absolute, you compare and you contrast. And there is a sense of responsibility on us as American Muslims that I could see very clearly by talking to people. And let me summarize. Everyone, almost everyone without exception, I talk to has a feeling that there is something called America that is overwhelmingly powerful, which is causing them to suffer immensely. That's across the board. And when you talk to them, they love American people. They even love American style and American way of life, and sometimes imitate it in a way that I see unhealthy. Nonetheless, they are aware that there is a power machine in America that is causing them to suffer immensely, either directly or by proxy. And this is a sense that I did not miss in anyone that I talked to. And as I said, even illiterate people, even very sophisticated people, that feeling that there is that machine that's causing them that suffering. The second thing is an immense feeling of frustration that they are unable to communicate or to explain their case to the American people. They tell you, America communicates with our people through media, through diplomats, through government, through movies, through arts, through fashion, but we are unable to communicate with the American people to tell them our case. And that also was a feeling of frustration across the board. The third thing is, they look at us American Muslims, and we were in that conference from the United States, three persons, and everyone looks at you with an eye of blame and with an eye of hope that we are supposed to do that on their behalf. We are supposed to be their vehicle to the American people to explain to them the sentiments and the suffering and the case of these millions and millions of masses that are living under these conditions. And you can't, I couldn't help but to feel that this is a very real, awesome responsibility that we cannot neglect. We cannot neglect because we are members of an ummah that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when one part of the ummah is suffering, the rest of the body responds in fever and sleeplessness. فَدَعَ لَهُ سَائِرُ الْأَعْضَاءِ بِالسَّهَرِ وَالْحُمَّ. It's also, as Muslims who believe in the religion that tells them to stand up for the downtrodden and the oppressed and the deprived, and makes it a religious duty. It's also our duty as American citizens who are so keen about the interests, the image, and the values of our country. So from every point of view, you feel that the responsibility on American Muslims is great. And we are supposed to do that they are expecting. And what is hindering us from doing that is not lack of resources. When you go there, you'll feel it is a joke that we talk about lack of resources. It's not lack of ability or capability or qualifications on brain power. No. It is because we are facing two hurdles in this country. One of them is political extremism, and the other one is religious extremism. The two issues that we are discussing in our conference this weekend, and by the way, please, if you haven't bought your ticket yet, on your way out, buy the tickets for the convention. Because it became so clear to me that being aware of those two powers and how to deal with them is of extreme importance, not only to us in America, but to the world. We have political extremism that wants to make this country an empire that conquers the world and suppresses dissent internally. There are those people, not everyone, but there is this power which is very real, and you know it and I know it. To them, America is a powerful empire that everybody should listen to, everybody should abide by, whether inside here or in the rest of the world. Religious fanaticism is based on a group of people who wanted to monopolize the country to make it a biblical country on the way they interpret the Bible. They have a special interpretation of the Bible, and if you don't accept this very specific way, you are condemned, not only in the hereafter, where they say it very clearly, you will not attain to salvation, but in this life you don't deserve to be a partner in a society that in their mind should be a Judeo-Christian biblical society according to a certain interpretation. And their interpretation goes far to dictate the values of people and goes far to make God giving a real estate thing to a specific group of people, simply because their interpretation of the Bible is like that. They read Genesis, and God talks to Abraham and tells him, to thy seeds I give this land, and they took it on their own to make thy seeds means Zionists from Poland or New York, not Muslim Christians and Jews who ought to live together in peace because they are the seeds of Abraham. It's a forgery. So that interpretation is part of the religious extremism that we are dealing with. We have to deal with those two powers for our sake and for the sake of the world and for the sake of the country itself. And this is what we are planning to study in this convention that's going to start tomorrow. I ask Allah for forgiveness for myself and ask Him for yours. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين. My dear Muslims, when we say we need to deal with these two hurdles, it's obviously that in generally speaking, we have to offer an alternative. We have an alternative to both. We believe in God Almighty, the creator of all people who are equal and will be judged by Him, not by us, on the day of judgment. And everybody has the right and the dignity that God bestowed upon all human beings just for being human beings. وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي Adam, all the progeny of Adam. We have the alternative of mercy and compassion to the faithful and unfaithful alike, and justice for all, the friend and the foe alike, according to the dictate of the Quran. We have an alternative of plurality of ideas and to pluralism of people, because the Quran stated that it hadn't been the will of your Lord to make all people in one group. He would have done it, but His will is diversity. وَلَوْ شَاءَ رَبُّكَ لَجَعْلَ النَّاسَ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً وَلَا يَزَالُونَ مُخْتَلِفِينَ وَلِذَلِكَ خَلَقَهُمْ. We have the alternative of everybody can believe the way he or she wants, but vie with each other and compete in doing goodness for humanity, because devotion to God means serving His servants and His subjects, starts by the most needy and the most urgent lack of service. This is where all resources should be directed to. So we have an alternative that is noble and that's good, and we can meet on this ground with so many people from all over, but we should never allow ourselves neither to be apologetic or defensive or having a sense of being victims or losing hope or being intimidated or being scared. Because if we do that, we are doing great disservice, number one, to our religion, number two, to ourselves, number three, to our new generation, number four, to our country in which we live, that needs alternatives on the table rather than being monopolized and exploited by political or religious extremists. It is quite a task, but together we can, we should, we ought to, at least to do the best we can to penetrate through the thickness of darkness to light, and to lead people from darkness to light, as it is the job of Muslims, who are a nation created for humanity. خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ الناس. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us our mistakes and to forgive us our forgetfulness. And I ask Him to make us very aware of our responsibilities and very capable of meeting them and carrying them. I ask Allah to give us the clarity of vision, the intelligence of the mind, and the courage of the heart to be worthy of working for His cause. I ask Him to forgive our mistakes and trespasses and shortcomings and to accept our deeds. Allahumma aghfir lana warhamna wa'afina wa'afu anna wa tawallana wa tub alayna innaka antat tawwabur rahim. وصلي اللهم على محمد أقم الصلاة.